Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you again for the gift of life, for the gift of the gospel of your word, but most certainly the gift of the word incarnate, Jesus Christ, through whom our covenant, the promise you have made that you will be our people, and we have promised that you will be our God. And in that covenant understanding of a deep rooted relationship, you have offered your son so that through him, your promise to give us the life with you forever can be experienced and will be the gift to all who turn to you in faith and accept your son, Jesus Christ. And so, dear God, be in my mouth and in my speaking, in my heart and in my loving, in my ears. May I hear the words of truth from everlasting. And in my eyes, may I see with gospel eyes beyond the surface to the deep truths of the reality of your love coming out from everlasting to your people on this planet, to all humanity, that through your son, you might give us the gift of life. And so in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Brothers and sisters, this morning, I would like to speak on the theme of the joys and benefits of life. Joys and benefits of a life lived in companionship with God. God wants us to live a life in companionship with him. And in that life lived in companionship with God, we will experience the joys. It's a joy that cannot be, that passes all understanding, because it's a joy that comes from the gift of the presence of God in our lives. And indeed, he's guiding us to understand that it is in him that we find our meaning and purpose. It is in him that we find our joys and our happiness. It is in him that we have life and life abundantly, in the way that God wants us to understand that abundant life. That abundant life is a life where we will experience and have everything we need. But brothers and sisters, everything we need comes in the person of Jesus Christ. And you know, yesterday at the convention, our bishop, Bishop Alan Gates, spoke to the diocese, to the clergy, and he spoke on the theme of searching for our humanity. And as he spoke to that theme of speaking to searching for humanity, I thought of myself, at what point did we discover we have lost our humanity? Because we were always created as human beings from the beginning. But what led to us needing to rediscover our humanity, the very source of our existence, the very way that God had identified us from the beginning? We have lost the sense of self in the myriad of different choices through generations. So my question is, why are we searching for what has always been true? Is that we have lost the sense of our true humanity that we were created to live into. And as he continues to speak, he expounded on the influence of the pandemic, which has caused us to focus on various things as Americans, to focus on the untested fragilities of it, of our social ecosystem. He spoke, and I am quoting these words out of his message. To a watching world, he says, the journalist Isabel Wilkinson said that the absence, to a watching world, the absence of one of the richest nations in the world, in spite of the richest nation of the world, there is an absence of scarcity of medical supplies. There is an absence of fair and affordable health care. There is an absence of disproportionate availability of affordable housing, which is mostly among ethnic minorities, the chaotic social distancing of rules, and the death tolls of so many people. And yet, in all of this characterization of where we are, it has forced us to look at ourselves in a way that we have never looked at ourselves before, perhaps. For he says, that sort of reflects the truth, which he thinks is a truth, that we are a civilization searching for our humanity. And he thinks that rings a truth. Given the reality of the intersecting battles that has to do with immigration around our borders, gun violence in our schools and homes, deepening economic inequities that continues, reaction to anti-racism efforts, and the polarizing and dehumanizing and demoralizing that comes with the rhetoric of our characterizations that we have in common. All these are wonderful words for me that says we are not treating each other in the loving way God wants us to treat us. That's the deepest truth in all of what is being said. I think it boils down to we have not treated each other as human beings. So we are searching for humanity. God has taught us to love each other, but what has happened? We have treated each other sometimes as material objects, and we have responded to people relating to them as if they're less than. And we have categorized people in such ways that we have lost sense that the truth that we as human beings that is created in God's image and God loves all of us. And so because of this message, they are lies, of course, they are lies, because the truth is God created us and he has told us from the beginning that we are created in his image. He experienced a loving relationship with Adam and Eve, our great, 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 great grandparents from which we are connected to. And we have just, because of a lie, the first lie came from the devil who tempted Adam and Eve to say that you don't have to listen to this God who loves you. He just doesn't want you to be like him. He just wants to keep you down. And for whatever reason, they listen to this stranger who has nothing to do and do not care about their life. And they listen to him and drag the whole of humanity down in the consequence of chaos and death and all the things that we're experiencing. And as we try to look forward to a future, we must understand that the human destiny is couched in this background of understanding that sin is sin and it is there with us, evil is evil, good is good, and that is something we have to find a way out of that reality to love one another and to listen to whom God has sent of how to deal with it and overcome it. See, there is a truth, and we cannot think about the pie in the sky without realizing all humanity has this problem. And God has revealed the problem with humanity so that as we try to live into a better life and a better future, he is telling us, number one, we got to recognize that he is God. There's a problem with humanity that caused all the chaos. And we have a choice. He invites us. The invitation is, because he gives us freedom of life, There, it is an invitation. He invites us into a relationship with him so that we can enjoy, in spite of that, the joys and benefits of a life that lives with companionship with him. He doesn't want to separate himself from us. You know, when we look at people who are living a life that we don't like, we want to separate ourselves from them because they're evil, because they're bad, they're not good influence, and that's understandable. But in spite of the brokenness and the disobedience and all that we are, the troublemakers we are, God loves us, and he does not desire to separate from us. He does not desire to separate from us. So as we search for our humanity, hopefully we will remember that we were never lost in the sight of God, really, because from the beginning, when Adam and Eve, when they disobeyed him, when they fell and were separated from him, he immediately responded in order to bring them back into the fold. So here is the kicker in this truth. When God rescued the children of Israel from slavery, they were refugees that he rescued from slavery in Egypt. And when he brought them into the desert to form them into a people that he would be called a special people, Leviticus tells us that while they were in the desert, Leviticus 11 verse 44 says, God said to the people, I am the Lord your God. Consecrate yourselves and be holy because I am holy. He says to them, consecrate yourselves to be holy because I am holy. God is not asking for perfect behavior. God is not asking them when he says that for perfect behavior. For if he was asking for perfect behavior, he would have skipped the sacrificial rituals that he himself instituted in order to set up a way of forgiving the sins of the people. You see, God anticipated that they would continue to sin, and in that anticipation and knowledge of the weakness and brokenness and what the problem of sin is, he set up a system to take care of sin. And so he himself said to them and gave them explicit guidelines. They're to sacrifice animals. And they're to sacrifice animals. And he explained why. They have a dietary rules that he gave them. And he told them to obey him. And he gave them the law. He gave them these things with an expectation that he said, that's how you show devotion to me. He wants us to show devotion to him. He doesn't expect us to be perfect, but he expects us to try to live into a faithful relationship of devotion to him. And so by that way, when he calls us holy, he's separating us from the ways of the world. Christians, because of Jesus and people who believe, if you believe in Christ, he's telling you, I want you to separate yourselves from living the way of the world, and I want you to live according to the guidelines I'm giving you. I want you to be devoted to me, and this is how you show your devotion. You keep my laws. You love each other. The sacrificial system in the Old Testament was necessary, and as the Hebrews reading shows, that sacrificial system in the Old Testament was set up in order to begin the process of forgiving the people who he knew would not totally be able to live into that obedience that is so much needed. So from the beginning, capital punishment is the consequence of sin. Capital punishment is the consequence of sin. And this sacrificial system was set up for the people to understand the seriousness of sin. We don't take sin seriously. We don't take it seriously. We got to take it seriously because it's serious. It caused the death of Jesus. It is responsible for us dying every day. It's responsible for us becoming ill. It's responsible for us as we continue to diminish each other. We continue to dehumanize each other. We begin to teach each other as objects, and we always get in the way of God's plan to help us. Because instead of seeking to be humble and to follow the teachings of God, we are filled with pride. We are filled with so much pride that we have elevated ourselves, and we have decided that we are going to do what we want to do, and we will name it as if we are doing God what God wants to do. And I'm not condemning everyone. We are confused people because of sin. We are confused people because of sin. So God said, by obeying me, you are expressing your devotion to me. And so this is what you do. You're to worship me. You're to obey the laws. You're to have the sacrificial system, because it's only through the death of this sacrifice can I forgive your sins. You can't just come and say, God, I'm sorry. Repentance and forgiveness requires the blood, which is the staff of life. It requires sacrifice. That is why, no matter what, Jesus had to die. Because if in the old days they went and said, God, I'm sorry, and they kept sinning, there's no way, because of the seriousness of sin, for God to address it, except when you sin, the consequence is death, and to overturn death, somebody got to die. There's accountability. And so you got to bring an animal. And when I see that animal, that blood will represent my son who will come in the future. And when you come with penitent hearts and I see that sacrifice, I will accept it. I will accept the repentant heart and I will forgive your sins. And when my son comes in the future, he will be sacrificed once and for all. He will replace that animal and he will become the lamb. And as Hebrews says, he will be sacrificed once for all. That's why we have Good Friday. Without Good Friday, there is no forgiveness. So as we plan a future with joy and happiness, where is our happiness? God's reality and truth says we cannot forget the consequence of sin that God is trying out of love to cover us with his sin, with his blood. When Adam and Eve sinned, the first death happened because God had to kill an animal. The Adam and Eve, the Bible tells us in Genesis, that when they sinned, that God covered themselves with clothing. That came from the death of an animal. So the first death of an animal, the sacrificial system, the sacrifice that was needed, went back to Adam and Eve when God covered their sins with the covering of an animal. It's in scripture. It is the truth. It's this to be taken seriously. We must not allow the glitters and the distractions of the world as we search for our humanity. Our humanity says God loves us, and that's the only thing we can be certain of. We cannot be certain of how long we would live. We cannot be certain about of our achievements. We cannot be certain about anything. We cannot be certain that this evening we will all be alive. But what we can be certain of, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's possession. Whether we live or die, God is with us. He is never going to leave us. And we have to come to him in faith. We must not be distracted. We must try to respect each other. We must try to love each other. We must try to be fair and just with each other. We must give each other space to be ourselves. We must give each other space to respect ourselves. We must listen to each other. We must not tell us, you are in your lane because you're female. You are in your lane because you're disabled. You are in your lane because you are white. You are in your lane because you're Spanish. God has made a diversity of people who are various ways, different personalities. And he wants unity in Christ. It is the blood of Christ that unites us, regardless of sex, regardless of race, regardless of physical challenges, regardless of what. There is a mystery about life that we do not understand. But one thing we must accept and be faith and know is true, that Jesus died so that all of us would have the same access to eternal life. He did not discriminate. He says, love me and try to obey my commandments. And when you fail, I will give my blood, because that is required in order to forgive your sins. And so Hebrews tells us this morning that in the Old Testament, in the temple, there was a curtain that separated the most holy of holies, where the earthly high priest would go to pray once a year for the sins of the people. And that curtain, when Christ died on behalf of our sins, that curtain was torn, because his body now became the curtain. And through him, we could access God directly, because he became the curtain and he is no longer separating us from God. Through him, we have access to God. Do we understand the seriousness of our life as we exploit to get the fancy things that the world is giving us? All the glitter, all the success do not take away from the truth of God's plan and what he is doing to save our life so that we can truly have a life. He doesn't care about the glamour of the world, although he gives it to us. He's concerned about how we care for the planet he has given us. He cares about how we treat each other. He cares about how we listen to him, because he's revealing a way of life, the way to life, the way to happiness, the way to true joys. You see, we place our joys in the external things that we have and we see, but they are temporary. True joys are to be found when the Spirit of God that dwells in you grants you peace in the midst of the chaos, grants you peace in the midst of feeling hopelessness. You can go through all kinds of trials and tribulations, but if you trust the Lord, you can smile to a person and say, I know I'm going to be okay, because I know my living God. I know I have a Savior, and he's not going to leave me. See, that's the only thing we are certain of. Even if you put your trust in anyone, they can become ill just like that. God can take them just like that. If you have millions of dollars, you could lose it just like that. If you have a beautiful home, you could lose it just like that. You could lose everything that's temporary just like that. But brothers and sisters, you have your Savior for eternity. You have him for eternity. And he will never abandon you for the grave. That's what the psalmist says. David loved the Lord so much. He knows that even in the grave, God will not abandon him, because he had an understanding of the resurrection. That's why he said to Jesus, my Lord, my God, because he recognized who Jesus was as the Messiah even before he died. And Jesus pointed at him, if I'm the son of David, why did God David call me Lord? Because David understand the revelation of who Jesus is. David loved the Lord. He was not perfect, but he loved the Lord. And he knew, because of that love, that God would never leave him, not even to the grave. And we got to develop that kind of faith. Brothers and sisters, the readings of today are focusing on the end times. Jesus isn't telling us how it will happen. He's telling us there'll be wars, there'll be famines, there'll be chaos, there'll be floods, there'll be pestilences, We are going through all that. So we know these are the signs. He's not going to tell us when, because he says only the Father knows when. He just tells you, in, he doesn't give things in a chronological order. He's just telling us these are the signs that's going to happen. The only thing we know for sure that the gospel tells us is that he's going to come as a thief in the night so that there will be no warning. That he's going to come from the clouds and we will all see. And he will make his appearance. That's all we know. And when it happens, it will usher in. I could be preaching and talking to you and it happens right now. Brothers and sisters, we do not know. We need to prepare ourselves. These are difficult times. We don't need to search for our humanity. God has already created us as human beings. We have only have to search it because we have lost it. And once we are living into the joys of a relationship ongoing with Jesus Christ, we will discover our true humanity in our relationship with God, and we can share it with each other. So if we have lost it, it's because we have been focusing on other things instead of focusing on God. And we become the very thing that we are focusing on. We become impersonal. We become cold. We become desensitized. We are losing our social ability to care and love. We cease to take care of the planet. And even now, we are choosing money over saving the planet. Something is wrong. Maybe we have lost our humanity, but we are still humans according to God. But we must learn to love one another. We must live a life of constantly thinking about the things of God every day. You know, we have a habit of planning what we want to do. And then we ask God to bless it. We plan our things. We're going to do this. We're going to do this. And then we say, God, you got to put your stamp of approval on that. That's not the way God wants us to live. He wants us to live a life of devotion to him. He wants us to come to him. And he wants us to talk to him about what we want to do. He wants us to seek our guidance and then to listen and take time to wait upon him. And then we make a decision that we hope is guided by him. But when we seek him first, we will begin to see that he responds in various ways, that we know he is truly guiding us. But when we take the bull by the horn and we just decide we're going to do this and we expect God to bless it, we are living an illusion. God is not going to bless what he does not want to bless, and he's not going to bless what we want to be blessed if we come to him with the wrong motivation. What is the reason why we come to God? He's not a bank. He wants a relationship. We got to bring our children up to know and love the Lord, no matter what the challenges of society says. The truth is, sin exists, our lives are challenged, our separation from God is threatened. Only through Christ can we be saved. And we got to get that story out no matter what. That is the eternal truth that we cannot allow to die. We must learn to treat each other. We must learn to respect each other. We must learn to listen to each other. Paul says, in Christ there is no male or female, we are one in Christ. Jesus says, love one another as I have loved you. Those are guidelines. He expects us to be devoted to him by listening to him and doing his will. And when we fail, he's offered his life. He's put his life on the line so that we might be forgiven. And we keep forgetting that. We keep wanting a life of happiness. But happiness is, God wants to give us more than the happiness. Happiness of the world. It's focused again on external things. And when those things disappear, we lose our happiness. But when our joy comes from knowing the Lord, when things disappear, we still have our joy because it's an inner experience that's grounded in the love of God. And God will never separate from us if we do not separate from him. We will always have his joy in our life. Whether we are rich or poor, we can have the joy in us. Whether we are success or we think we are failures, we can still have the joy of the Lord in us. Because we know we have one person who loves us, no matter what we are, no matter what. Even when we fail, the love is an unconditional love. If we have faith and believe in that, we can remove mountains like a lost mustard seed. Brother, do you believe it? Do you believe it? Reflect on your life. I must reflect on my life. God wants us to enjoy the eternal gift of his love now and forever. He doesn't want us to just wait until the time that we are together in eternity. He wants us to experience the joys of his love now, and that flows through eternally. He invites us into relationship with him. Those who see God can move into the future confidently, for they know what's important. What is important is to serve God. Those who do not know God, they have a sense of hopelessness about life and confusion over their true purpose on earth. But if your purpose is to see God and to love God, he will give you an understanding of a purpose in life. If nothing else, when you live to please him, you will find the joys that God will give you. So don't base your circumstances on anything but on God. Don't base your security on anything but on God. Don't base your healing on anyone or anything more than God. Don't suffer for anyone more than you would suffer on behalf of God. Choose God always, brothers and sisters, and through obeying him and devotion to him, share your love for one each other like the brightness of the stars, as Daniel said. Who like these are stars of shining? We must shine, representing Jesus. Are we shining? We must go out into the world to shine, representing Christ in the love, fighting for justice, helping to get rid of these forces that continue to dehumanize us and separate us from one another, and allow the love of God to unite us. Do not allow positions of power, or the male and female, or the adult and the child, separate us, that we are fighting among ourselves. Allow the love of God to unite us so that we can live for him and live for the life that he wants to bless us with. So brothers and sisters, the real threat to our life is this sin. The real threat to our lives is the liar Satan, who continues to tempt us to think of things that is more important than God. And God is helping us to see through the lies to the truth, so that we may follow him who is truth, so that we may follow him who is the way, so that we can follow him who has created us, so that we can follow him that has given us our value. Our value is not determined by anyone but God. And in that value, we can treat each other with respect. We can affirm the dignity of every human being. We can show love to the stranger, likewise, those we know. We can find a way to be united in the love of Christ, to work through our difficulties so that we can come out at the other end, truly seeking to devote to God. Father, God deserves more than we are trying to do. He does. Even with me, I confess it. He deserves more of our devotion, more of our commitment, more of our love. The devil has come to steal our joy. Don't let him steal our joy. Our joy comes from the one who makes us. Our joy comes from the one who died for us. Our joy comes from the one who wants us to have everlasting life with him for eternity. Amen.